Hello and welcome to this edition of Wineskins, a program that features reflections on the lives of the saints and sacred scriptures, along with information on topics and issues from a Catholic perspective. I'm Father Jim Korda. Wineskins is brought to you by the annual Bishop's Appeal, the Catholic Communication Campaign, and St. Paul's Catholic Books and Gifts, a division of the Society of St. Paul. On our show today, I will interview Dave Schmidt on walking with moms in need. We will also look at the life of St. Damian of Molokai, as well as reflections on the readings for this fourth Sunday of Easter. That and more coming up on Wineskins. In our current issue, I will speak with Father Joe Ruggieri on vocations. With me now is Father Joe Ruggieri, who is the Director of Seminarians for the Diocese of Youngstown. Father Joe, welcome to Wineskins.
Thank you. My pleasure. Newly appointed, yes.
And we want to talk about that new position you received, and especially the number of seminarians that we have right now. Mm-hmm. You know, in this day and age of fewer priests, it's wonderful to have the amount of seminarians that we do have. In your new position, what exactly will you be doing with our seminary?
Well, Father Scott Kopp, who is the actual vocations director, he is still in charge of actually recruiting. He's the one out there, you know, trying to find the guys to sign up to go into the seminary. And so once he recruits them, once he fills out all the paperwork with them, they meet with the bishop and they meet with the seminary staff, they get enrolled in the seminary. Once they actually officially become seminarians, then they become my responsibility. So that's like, that's where they pass the torch off onto me. And so I am in charge of guiding their training through the seminary process. I'm the liaison between the bishop and the diocese and the seminary and the seminarians. Yeah, but it is good that we have that many. That kind of reminds me back when I was in the seminary back in the early 90s, yes.
Let's talk also about some of the places that the guys go to. It used to be, you know, we went to Mount St. Mary's in Cincinnati, mm-hmm. but they go to Cleveland now. Talk about that and maybe some of the other seminaries that they're involved with.
All of the seminaries are still open. I mean, it's not that we've closed the door to going to them, but I think the bishop is moving in the direction, like we had, again, years ago, of the idea of that fraternity that's built with all the guys having that common experience under one roof and going through the same kind of formation process, which, again, it has its pros and cons. I'm sure you can argue in either direction with it. But the Cleveland Seminary, again, has been the one that's most attractive to the bishop and to the vocations directors that I'm succeeding. So I think that's why they've gone in that direction. Not that there's anything wrong with the Josephinum in Columbus or Mount St. Mary's in Cincinnati, but I think the proximity in Cleveland, mm-hmm. I think that kind of rebuilding that relationship between the Diocese of Youngstown and the Diocese of Cleveland, I think, that's a good thing. We're working so close together already.
Sure. And it does make sense. And the other thing is that proximity of the guys closer to their own diocese, mm-hmm. where they can come home for special events or functions.
Yeah.
Whereas if they were in Cincinnati, I remember we came back very seldom, only on the high holidays or during the summer. So this is really a wonderful opportunity for them to maybe even be more involved in their own home parish. I'd like to ask about that. Is there some involvement for them in their own home parish, or do they go to other parishes to get some training?
Early on, especially for the college seminarians, the relationship is still more with their home parish. Once they get into the graduate school, into the major seminary, they get an assignment. They get a summer assignment when they're home on summer. They're either in a parish or they're doing something with one of the diocesan offices, those kind of non-parochial ministries that the diocese has. So, yeah, it's kind of weaning them away from their home parish at that point and then developing that attachment to other parishes in the diocese leading up to their internship. And then once they enter into their internship, then that kind of becomes their relationship parish until they get ordained. They have that entire year where they're in that parish and they have those friendships. I think that's worth maintaining when they go back fourth or for the third and fourth and final year in the seminary.
So. And maybe we'll talk a little bit more about that particular program at another mm-hmm. opportunity. In this position that you're in now, what would you like to see happen with seminarians, but also in their formation on the road to priesthood?
Well, one of the problems that I have spoken to the bishop about, and even to Father Kopp, is that right now, a lot of the seminaries, and I think this was one of the problems that led us to going to Cleveland, was that the seminaries were fostering more of a monastic lifestyle, and it really wasn't helping the guys to learn to become diocesan priests. So I think that the guys need as much parish Irish experience as they can get to kind of get them used to this is the day-to-day life of a priest in the parish, not being locked behind the walls of a seminary with that kind of a, you know, routine and regimen of daily prayer. I mean, they have to be able to do that on their own as well, which, I mean, it's good that they learn that in the seminary. But just getting those guys out there into the parishes to meet people and to be more pastoral one-on-one with people in a parish setting, I think that's probably a better angle to look at in their training.
What would you tell the folks that are with us to do or not to do with our diocesan seminarians?
I can't think of anything not to do. I mean, of course, pray for them. I mean, they need all the support that they can get, you know, spiritually and just, you know, moral support. When you see them, if they're in your parish, be sure to go up and congratulate them or offer them your support and as they continue, you know, and then as they get ordained, you know, welcome the newly ordained guys into your parish and, you know, and especially welcome them into your home. I think that was the joy when I was first ordained was getting into their life. They would invite me to their homes for dinner and to kind of be a part of their life, you know, baptizing children and doing weddings and all the other things are, you know, are important, you know, for newly ordained and for seminarians as well. I think just keeping them in your prayers and remembering that they're human beings that need that kind of contact and just to be out there socializing as well, not just doing the stuff at church.
Well, Father Joe Ruggieri is Diocesan Director of Seminarians. Thank you for being with us. We look forward to your presence again on Wineskins, and thank you for the job you're doing. We know it's important, and we know that our diocesan seminarians appreciate that. So thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity. I'm glad to be here.
For Wineskins, I'm Father Jim Korda. This month, the church celebrates a feast of Damien of Molokai. To tell us more is Joan Lawson. She is from St. Patrick Church in Youngstown and a religious education consultant for the Diocese of Youngstown.
When Josef de Wooster was born, few people in Europe had any firsthand knowledge of leprosy. By the time he died at the age of 49, people all over the world knew about this disease because of him. They knew that human compassion could soften the ravages of this disease. The leper priest, the hero of Molokai, was born in Belgium on January 3, 1840. In 1860, he entered the Congregation of the Sacred Hearts of Jesus and Mary, taking the name of the first Saint Damien, 4th century physician and martyr. When his brother, a priest of the same congregation, fell ill and was unable to go to the Hawaiian Islands as assigned, Damien quickly volunteered in his place. In May 1864, 2 months after arriving in his new mission, Damien was ordained a priest in Honolulu and assigned to the island of Hawaii. In 1873, after volunteering for the assignment, he went to the leper colony of Molokai, set up 7 years earlier. In time, he became their most effective advocate to obtain promised government support. Soon the settlement had new houses and a new church, school, and orphanage. A few years later, he succeeded in getting the Franciscan Sisters of Syracuse, led by Mother Mary Ann Cope, to help staff this colony in Molokai. At his canonization, Pope Benedict said of him, "Not without fear and loathing, Father Damien made the choice to go on the island of Molokai in the service of lepers who were there, abandoned by all. Thus he was exposed to the disease from which they suffered. With them, he felt at home. The servant of the word became a suffering servant, a leper with the lepers for the last 4 years of his life." Damien cared for lepers of all ages, but was particularly concerned about the children segregated in the colony. He announced he was a leper in 1885 and continued to build hospitals, clinics, churches, and some 600 coffins. He died on April 15, 1888 on Molokai. As requested, he was buried there, but in 1936, the Belgian government succeeded in having his body moved to Belgium. Part of Damien's body was returned to his beloved Hawaiian brothers and sisters after his beatification in 1995. When Hawaii became a state in 1959, it selected Damien as one of its 2 representatives in the Statuary Hall at the U.S. Capitol. He was declared venerable in 1977. Pope John Paul II declared him beatified on June 4, 1995, and Pope Benedict XVI declared him saint on October 11, 2009, in the presence of King Albert II and Queen Paula of Belgium as well as the Belgian Prime Minister and several cabinet members. Some people thought Damien was a hero for going to Molokai, and others thought he was crazy. To follow Christ, Damien not only left his homeland, but also staked his health so that he might receive eternal life. Damien's symbols are a tree and a dove. In St. Damien's role as unofficial patron of those with HIV and AIDS, the world's only Roman Catholic memorial chapel to those who have died of this disease at Montreal, Quebec, is consecrated to him. The opening prayer of the Mass is this: God our Father, in St. Damien of Molokai, you gave a light to your faithful people. You made him a pastor of the church to feed your sheep with his word and to teach them by his example. Help us by his prayers to keep the faith he taught and follow the way of life he showed. For Wineskins, I'm Joan Lawson.
With me today is Dave Schmidt, who is the director of the Office of Pro-Life, Marriage, and Family Ministry for the Diocese of Youngstown. Dave, welcome back to Wineskins.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
You're a regular on Wineskins practically every month, and I remember last month you spoke to us about a special program called Walking with Moms in Need, and I think we'd like to talk a little bit more about that program, primarily because, as you had mentioned before, there's a lot of women who are pregnant in our midst, mothers-to-be, and the church wants to really do things for them and walk with them, their good times and bad times. Let's talk a little bit about that program and why it's so important for us here in the diocese, but also in the church.
I think it's inspired in a lot of ways by a couple of teachings of Pope Francis. One is he challenges us to make our parishes islands of mercy in a sea of indifference. And when he puts that, I mean, even though he's not necessarily, when he says that, speaking specifically to women who are in crisis pregnancies, but that's what a lot of women in crisis pregnancies face. They run into indifference, not knowing it. I've talked to people who have had abortions who have said if anybody in their life had shown any care, had shown them that there's another way to go, they wouldn't have made the decision that they did. In fact, studies bear out that over half of women who have abortions feel they had no other choice. Some of them were downright coerced into it. Some of them just felt that there were no other options. Nobody presented anything to them, any other way to go. So with Walking with Moms in Need, the goal is, to use another phrase from Pope Francis, is to go to the fringes. And the best people to go to the fringes are actually our parishioners. In all honesty, a woman who is in a crisis pregnancy, who's contemplating the possibility of abortion, probably isn't going to call one of our parishes up. But she might talk to somebody at work. She might talk to somebody at school. And if the somebody she happens to talk to happens to be one of our parishioners who at least has an inkling through the Walking with Moms in Need efforts that there's resources out there that are available to her and can try to point her in the right direction, maybe that could make the difference. Maybe that could be life-saving.
You had also mentioned last time you were here that parishes are really working together on a regional basis, mm-hmm. which is what we are striving to do as a diocese more and more, is to share resources. What are some of those specific resources that parishes have at their disposal that they could assist pregnant moms?
Well, what first comes to mind is in every county of our diocese, there is at least one crisis pregnancy center called a pregnancy help center. They go by different names and so forth, and they're at the front lines in this. They are trying to reach out to pregnant women who are in crisis situations. And just to be able to point them in that direction, it would be a huge help. In researching this myself and learning about this, it's almost overwhelming. It's quite inspiring that our, for instance, our Catholic hospitals have some amazing programs for women who are expecting, for parenting moms, to teach them skills, give them support. Again, the problem with a lot of the organizations, like our Catholic hospitals and such, is they don't have advertising budgets. They put all their efforts towards their ministries. So to put our parishioners in a position where they're helping direct them to such, and of course our Catholic Charities agencies, as we've been doing some research into this and asking questions, because you get people from like those different institutions together and you say, what else is out there? And they'll point out that there's diaper banks, there's families who have created their own foundations to do things like make diapers available to anybody in need. There's programs out there to provide car seats. There's programs to provide children's clothing and so forth. So, of course, a notable notable one is our own First Step for Change program through Catholic Charities. Again, it's quite inspiring. It's a matter of connecting the person in the crisis pregnancy to the resources that are out there. And we see the average Jane and Joe in the pew as being indispensable in helping to make that connection.
Let's talk about putting a face to those people that come to us. You know, oftentimes when we think of women who are pregnant that are in need, we automatically think that they're alone or they're homeless or they're impoverished. But women in need who are pregnant may necessarily not be in that situation. They may have a husband, they may have other children, and yet somehow this current pregnancy that they find themselves in is a burden to them or a struggle. Why is that, and what can we do specifically for those that are in seemingly good situations?
Well, as you were asking that, I'm thinking of one population. It's not certainly not the only population, but one population that often falls into that description is the college age. A young lady goes to school, she's not under parents' supervision anymore, maybe makes some bad decisions, finds herself with an unexpected pregnancy, and now all her career goals, her educational goals, just seem to be unraveling. And her life, as she's planned it out, she seems to be dying. I've heard women who have contemplated abortion say it was either, you know, my life or the baby's life, but of course that doesn't have to be that way. If people in her life show that they care for her, support her, will help her get through it, maybe her plans may be delayed a year, 2, 3 years, but she can still fulfill her dreams while at the same time giving her child a chance at life.
Let's say that there are folks that are with us that would like more information on this particular program of Walking with Moms in Need. Where do they go to? Where do they get more information? Who do they call?
Well, it's very much in the process of development. Most basically is to call the Office of Pro-Life Marriage and Family Life at the Catholic Diocese of Youngstown. I hope that we will have a lot of the resources appearing on the diocesan website as this develops. As of right this moment, that does not exist yet, but I hope by the time this airs, that there is something there.
And I think the important thing is that you will steer them in the right direction.
Yes.
Whether it's in a parish or an institution that provides programming for women in need who are pregnant. And give us the number to the diocese for their help.
It's 330-744-8451. And they can reach me at extension 272.
Dave Schmidt, as always, we thank you for your presence on Wineskins and for your information, but also for what you do for pro-life marriage and family life in the Diocese of Youngstown.
Well, thank you.
For Wineskins, I'm Father Jim Korda. For more information and to listen to Wineskins, visit the website of the Catholic Diocese of Youngstown at www.doy.org. Stay with us. We'll be back in a moment.
What have you done for your marriage today?
I gave my wife a hug this morning. I told her I love her.
I did her hair this morning. I think it looks pretty good.
I cooked my husband's favorite breakfast.
I bought her an orchid.
What have I done for my marriage today? I sent my husband a love email.
I read the newspaper to my wife, and it cracked her up. She's still laughing.
What have you done for your marriage today? Make a change for the better. Need help? Go to foryourmarriage.org. A message from the Catholic Church.
33 million Americans have descended into poverty. And as their futures fall, so does our nation's.
The song we have for you today is from the CD called Mary, A Light in Darkness. It is by the Kellenberg Memorial High School Choir.
When I am down, and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. Raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. And I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
And to tell us about the scriptures for this fourth Sunday of Easter is Father Jim McKarns. He is Pastor Emeritus of St. Paul Church in North Canton.
Some years ago, a high school senior named Steve took an aptitude test to determine what courses he would take in college. He was thinking of going into scientific research. A few days later, his guidance counselor came in to review his test. He said, "Well, Steve, your scores and your preferences and your abilities look like you're extremely well qualified to be a shepherd." Steve said, "A shepherd? What do you mean, that takes care of sheep?" The counselor said, "No doubt about it. It's unmistakable." And in his confusion, then he heard a voice saying, "Smile, you're on candid camera." Just to give a brief explanation for maybe younger people who don't know about candid camera, that was a 30-minute reality TV show that ran for 50 years in the 1960s and following. A concealed camera would film people in unusual and comical situations. That's where Steve didn't know what he was to do, and it was a joke. I wonder what Steve is doing today, but I'm rather sure he's not a shepherd, because the culture does not really aspire to be shepherds today. In our gospel reading at this Mass, Jesus does speak about sheep and shepherds, and his contemporaries would really easily relate to that teaching. Famous shepherds were like King David, to protect the flock from the lions and the bears. There was the prophet Amos, who was a shepherd. Jesus calls himself a shepherd. "I am the good shepherd." Shepherds have four major responsibilities: lead the sheep to find water, provide for food, give them shelter, and see that the sheep are protected and made safe. Jesus said he was a shepherd, but not in a literal sense. And in fact, we are sheep, but we are not sheep in a literal sense. It's by analogy. The shepherd loves us and cares for us like the shepherd cares for the sheep. It's a relationship. It's a close bond between the Lord and the people, between the shepherd and the sheep. The word Latin is a word that we use for shepherd taken right out of the Latin language. The Latin word is pastor. Pastor means shepherd. The pastor brings the people to the waters of baptism, to the Holy Eucharist, the spiritual food, to the shelter of the church, the protection and the help for the sick and the anointing, consolation to the sorrowful. These are the duties of the pastor, of the shepherd. Psalm 23 is the famous psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd." It really means, "The Lord is my pastor." Jesus said, "I came that they might have life and have it more abundantly." If we are sheep without a shepherd, then we are lost. We are thirsty and hungry and ill and cold and fearful. So, folks, we need to listen to the voice of the shepherd. He is calling you to follow him. What a friend we have in Jesus, for the Lord is my pastor. For Wineskins, I'm Father Jim McKarns.
Great character cannot be built on negatives alone, but neither can they be built without a few. The things that we do not do ultimately play a major role in who we are and in what we accomplish. Wineskins is made possible through the annual Bishop's Appeal, the Catholic Communication Campaign, and St. Paul's Catholic Books and Gifts. The program is produced by CTNY, the Catholic Telecommunications Network of Youngstown. I'm Father Jim Korda, saying thank you for being with us. Have a blessed week, and let us remember to pray for vocations to the priesthood and religious life on this World Day of Prayer for Vocations.
What have you done for your marriage today?
I gave my wife a hug this morning. I thought I love her.
I did her hair this morning. I think it looks pretty good.
I cooked my husband's favorite breakfast.
I bought her an orchid.
What have I done for my marriage today? I sent my husband a love email.
I read the newspaper to my wife, and it cracked her up. She's still laughing.
What have you done for your marriage today? Make a change for the better. Need help? Go to foryourmarriage.org. A message from the Catholic Church.
They say America is the land of opportunity, but for some, life isn't so easy. Right now in America, 1 in 6 children lives below the poverty line. That's nearly 13 million children of all races, all across our country. Where do you draw the line and get involved? You can make a difference in more ways than you think. Go to povertyusa.org today, because 1 in 6 children in poverty is one too many. A message from the Catholic Campaign for Human Development.